Today we're going to talk about MCAT physics. Many students struggle with physics in college and assume that they will struggle with physics on the MCAT. In addition, many students who have taken practice exams find themselves forgetting equations or getting tripped up by seemingly complex math. If that sounds like you, you're not alone. I'm Vikram Shah, MCAT expert and 528 MCAT scorer. In this video, we will go over study strategies you can use to wade through the sea of equations, formulas, graphs, and math. My goal for this video is for you to walk away understanding what topics are in the exam, how to approach seemingly impossible practice problems, and how to study your mistakes so that you don't make them again on test day. Let's get started. How much physics is actually on the MCAT? First, a little MCAT physics overview. When you take the MCAT, the exam is broken down into four sections. The first section tests you on chemistry and physics with 59 questions. 44 of these questions are passage-based, while 15 are standalone questions. Physics falls into this chemistry and physics, or chem-phys section. According to the AAMC, physics will be about 25% of your chemistry-physics section, give or take 5%. So that means between 20 to 30% of your MCAT chem-phys section will focus on physics. In other words, your exam will likely contain between 12 and 18 questions discussing physics. Since chemistry physics is only one of four sections, however, physics plays a smaller role in your overall score. In fact, physics will actually be only about 5 to 7% of your entire exam, or 12 to 18 questions out of 230 total questions. Now, let's get into a general overview of the topics the AAMC will test you on in the chemistry and physics section, and study strategies you can use to answer difficult questions. Students often wonder what physics subjects will show up, so we've broken it down for you here. We will discuss strategies in the context of the first few topics, but they will apply to the remaining topics mentioned as well. So, let's get started. Topic 1 covers what generally corresponds to the first semester of physics at your university: translational motion, forces, energy, work, and equilibrium. The difference, however, is that you are applying these concepts to biological systems. A Topic 1 question is not likely to ask, if Sarah throws a rock off of a cliff, how far in the ocean does it land? Instead, a physics-like question on the MCAT might ask, how much work is done when a protein is extended by 5 nanometers using 50 piconewtons of force? Like many students, terms such as work or force ring a bell in your head, but you may not have the formulas on the tip of your tongue. However, just as it is essential on the MCAT to know your amino acids backwards and forwards, big formulas like the work or force formulas are no exception. What do we mean by big formulas? We define a big formula for the MCAT as any formula you see on an AAMC practice question, whether it comes from the question packs or one of the AAMC full-length exams. If a formula shows up on AAMC practice questions, it is fair game for your actual exam. So we will now introduce MCAT physics strategy number 1. Know the big formulas and their units. How does this strategy help us? Let's go back to our example. How much work is done when a protein is extended by 5 nanometers using 50 piconewtons of force? If we know that the formula for work is work equals force times distance, we can solve this question by simply multiplying 5 nanometers by 50 piconewtons. A lot of students tend to panic when asked physics questions in a biological context. We are much more used to seeing the following question: how much work is done when a student moves a block 5 meters using 50 newtons of force? Remember, the formulas you are using here are the exact same. The multiplication from our original problem, 5 nanometers by 50 piconewtons, brings us to another point that students often struggle with. How do we multiply 5 times 10 to the negative 9th by 50 times 10 to the negative 12th? MCAT math is tricky, but it's manageable. You're not allowed to use a calculator on the exam, and the AAMC knows this. Use it to your advantage with strategy number 2. Let the answer choices guide your approach to math problems. Let's say the four answer choices for our problem are: A, 1.5 times 10 to the negative 18th joules; B, 2.5 times 10 to the negative 19th joules; C, 2.55 times 10 to the negative 20 joules; and D, 5.5 times 10 to the negative 21 joules. At first glance, those answer choices look tricky because they are very similar, but let's take an even closer look. Let's say we simplified our math by removing the scientific notation. So we go from 5 times 10 to the negative 9th times 50 times 10 to the negative 12th to 5 times 50. That's easier, right? We know the answer is 250. Now, let's simplify the answer choices by removing the scientific notation in our problem. The four answer choices for our problem are now 1.5 joules, 2.5 joules, 2.55 joules, and 5.5 joules. Which answer choice is most similar to 250? If you said answer choice B, you would be correct. It does not matter where we place the decimal. Anytime we multiply 5 by 50, we'll get a number that looks similar to 250, but not 150, choice A, 255, choice C, or 550, choice D. Without even looking at the scientific notation, we were able to determine the correct answer. Let's say, however, the answer choices for our problem look something like this. A, 250 times 10 to the negative 18th joules. B, 250 times 10 to the negative 19th joules. C, 250 times 10 to the negative 20th joules. And D, 250 times 10 to the negative 21 joules. Now, we do care about the scientific notation. How do we multiply 5 times 10 to the negative 9th by 50 times 10 to the negative 12th? Use this tip. Think of solving the problem as a two-part process. First, multiply the numbers before the scientific notation. When we multiply 5 by 50, we get 250. Second, add the exponent values, which are negative 9 and negative 12 in this case. There's no need to fear this math equation either. If we add two negative numbers together, we get an even bigger negative number. Negative 9 plus negative 12 is the same thing as negative 9 minus 12, or minus 21. When we piece together step 1, which was 250, and step 2, which was negative 21, we arrive at answer choice D, 250 times 10 to the negative 21. Now that we've covered scientific notation, let's look at another, slightly different problem. The MCAT physics section will contain graphs, and you should make these graphs your friend in order to answer these physics questions correctly. Let's say the passage gave you this graph. Figure 1, dependence of force on tweezer speed. And then let's say the question reads, what is the power exerted on a protein when the tweezer speed is 10 meters per second? A, 100 watts, B, 50 watts, C, 25 watts, or D, 15 watts? Here, let's look at two more strategies. MCAT physics strategy number 3. Pay attention to images and graphs, especially axis labels and the title, as they may hide key information needed to answer your question. And MCAT physics strategy 4, use the units to your advantage. So, let's apply those strategies to our problem. You look at the title, which talks about a force and a speed. The x-axis defines a tweezer speed in nanometers per second, and the y-axis defines a force in newtons. The question stem is asking about power, and using MCAT physics strategy number 1, we know that the equation for power is work over time, or W over T. You look at the graph, however, and there is no work over time, but don't panic. Here, MCAT physics strategy 4, or using the units to your advantage, kicks in, and you can break down the units that you do have. Power is equal to work over time, and the units are joules per second. We know that the equation for work is force times distance, and force is represented by newtons, while distance is represented by meters. So let's replace joules with newtons times meters. So our first equation is power, which is equal to work over time. The units for power are joules per second. The next equation is work, which is equal to force times distance, and the units for work are newtons times meters. Now, let's combine these two equations. Power can now be equal to force times distance divided by time, and the units would be newtons times meters divided by seconds. Now, you look back to the graph and see that our final unit solution for power includes all of the units on both axes. The y-axis has newtons, and we see newtons in our new power equation. The x-axis has meters and seconds, and we also see meters and seconds in our equation. If you multiply the units on the x-axis, meters per second, by the units on the y-axis, newtons, you get the same units as the power equation that we derived. So, all that is left to do is find where the tweezer speed is 10 meters per second, find that point on the line, and see what the corresponding value is for force. The value is 10 newtons, so we multiply 10 by 10 and get our answer, 100 watts. And remember, watt is a unit for power. Before we move on to the next topic, let's summarize what we've discussed so far with 5 takeaway points. Mastering the MCAT physics section is within your grasp. Here is takeaway number 1. From now on, for every physics question you take using AAMC test materials, write the formula down along with relevant units and variables on a sheet of paper or flashcards until you've compiled a comprehensive list of all of the formulas and units you need to know. For example, for force you would write, force is equal to mass times acceleration. In addition to writing this formula down, you would also want to include the variable letter and the units. Takeaway number two, do not get overwhelmed by physics math problems. Let the answer choices guide your approach and don't spend too much time on hard math if there is a shorter path to the answer. Takeaway number three, always, always, always read the title of a graph and the axes as they can help you solve seemingly complex problems. Takeaway number four, remember your units and how they relate to one another. And here's a final piece of advice before we move on to the remaining MCAT physics topics. Takeaway number five, if you find yourself spending more than 1 to 1.5 minutes on any given physics problem, choose your best guess, flag it, move on, and come back to it at the end of your section if you have time. Now, we will cover the remaining MCAT physics topics that you will see on your exam. Again, we will not cover every topic in depth here so that we can show you the high yield strategies, but we'll provide the full list at the end of the video. MCAT physics topic number two covers fluids in the body, including blood circulation, gas movement, and gas exchange. Here's an example problem. At which of the following locations in the body is hydrostatic pressure the greatest if a student is standing up? A, feet, B, knees, C, hands, or D, head? Using MCAT physics strategy number one, we should recall the formula for hydrostatic pressure. Even though no numbers are used in this problem, we can use the formula to our advantage. MCAT physics strategy number five says that formulas show us relationships that help answer non-math questions. Now, how do you solve this problem? Do you remember the formula for hydrostatic pressure? Remember MCAT physics takeaway number one. If this was an AAMC problem, when you come back and review the question, you would add the hydrostatic pressure formula to your list of formulas. Hydrostatic pressure is the pressure in a given liquid at a certain depth. The formula is pressure is equal to density times gravity times height or depth. In variable terms, this formula is P is equal to rho times G times H. D, or density, is often notated by rho, or a tilted P. Now, how does this equation relate back to our situation? Let's think of the student as a container of blood, with the student's head being the top of this container, and the student's feet being the bottom of this container. Now, back to our formula, pressure is equal to density times gravity times height. Since the fluid density and gravity will be the same in this student's case, the only variable we can alter is depth. If we define the top of the container as height 0, where is the deepest part of the container? Is the container deepest where it corresponds to the student's head, hands, knees, or feet? If you said feet, then you are correct. Pressure and depth are directly proportional according to our formula. So when depth is the greatest, pressure will also be the greatest, and you will choose feet as your answer. The two main variable relationships you should be familiar with are directly proportional and inversely proportional. A direct relationship means that one variable will increase with the other, and it looks like this. X is equal to Y. When Y increases, so must X. An inverse relationship means that if one variable increases, the other must decrease. You might draw it like this. X is equal to 1 over Y. When Y increases, X decreases. So here's MCAT physics takeaway number six. Be able to apply direct and inverse proportionality to equations in order to solve non-math problems. We will now mention the remaining topics in the ChemViz section, and you can apply the strategies and takeaways we have talked about to topics 3 through 10. Topic 3 covers electrochemistry and electrical circuits. Topic 4 covers optics and sound. Topic 5 covers atoms, nuclear decay, electrical structure, and atomic chemical behavior. Topic 6 covers water and its solutions. Topic 7 covers molecules and their interactions. Topic 8 covers separations and purifications. Topic 9 covers the structure, function, and reactivity of macromolecules. And finally, topic 10 covers thermodynamics and kinetics. Note, some of these topics are more physics-oriented, such as topic 1, so you will likely see more physics-related questions on that topic during your exam. If you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up and subscribe so you don't miss out on new videos. And if you'd like to receive a free MCAT question of the day to get every last bit of practice in before your exam, click the link in the description. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.